So don't forget, church by appointment, bring mask unless lifted. That's the church phone number if you guys don't already know, which is basically my cell. Anyways, so we're doing, this may change next week, but as of right now, they may open up the numbers. And so if they do that, I will definitely drop the 8 to 9. Sunday, 8 to 9, 9:30 to 10:30, 11 to 12, and 12:30 to 1:30 right now are the times. I do need a call, and I do need you to book, all right? And if you call, and you have to be a little flexible if it's already booked up, all right? And so that's how we're going to run it right now. We'll try to stay within the guidelines, and hopefully they'll open up a little bit more next week and make it a little easier, all right? So, so welcome back. Right? Welcome back. Yes, I know. Finally, right? We are going to do the Lord's Supper. I'm going to figure a time when we get rolling again. So we will have a service just for that. And we'll do like the Easter service that we usually do. But we will do the Lord's Supper. That will be coming up also. And Hebrews 10:25, it says, "And let us not neglect our meeting together." So that's the pressure on a pastor during times like this, that when God says to do something and a pastor's here not allowing people to do it, it falls back on him. And so that's why you see sometimes the resistance of pastors, because we know that that calling is upon us. And the calling upon you guys is not to neglect coming to church, right? And so if you're sitting at home and watching, it's okay, but make sure you once a week are visiting and having fellowship with other Christians. Right, and so, and then it says that as some people do, right? Don't neglect the meeting of ourselves together, as some people do, right? Don't fall into that class, right? And then, but encourage one another. It means, come on, let's go to church. Encourage one another, right? Especially now that the day of His return is drawing near. If you can't see that now, you are never going to see it. And so, especially now, God says, don't neglect the time to come together. And listen, church is an essential business, right? That was proclaimed by the president. That's a good best proclamation I've heard in a while, right? It is essential. This country was founded under Christianity, right? Under God we trust, right? I mean, the fact that this whole nation was built on God. It is essential because prayer is powerful and it can change things. Right? And then we group together, we have more power. And I put Maria and Jose up there because I was watching Facebook a little bit this week, and Maria and Jose, their husband and wife, and Maria was out in her yard, and she was on her lounge chair, and she's kind of relaxing, and she said, "I'm just relaxing." And I wrote on there, "That's not essential business, right? Get in there and cook and clean. That's essential, right?" So we can actually list a lot of essential and non-essentials during this time. But the fact is, church, listen, church is an essential, right? So the title of the message today is We Belong to Something New. Do you realize that? Do you realize you belong to something new? Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, to gather, Lord. Sometimes when you take things away, Lord, it means all that much more. And so we thank you for time to gather, and we pray you bless the time and speak to our hearts, God, as always. And I pray you'd open up America, get them back to work for the healing of the people who are sick. And for wisdom and guidance by the presidents and the leaders, Lord, to get the nation back up and running, God. And we pray for your power and a God, Lord, as we talked about last week, who would do the impossible, God, and make it possible. Amen. In Jesus' name, amen. So we belong to something new. Listen, and baptism is a representation of a new life. And so that's really, if you've accepted the Lord as your Savior, your next step is to get baptized. That's the very first commandment after you're saved. It's repent and be baptized, right? So if you haven't been baptized, talk to me, all right? But anyways, it is a picture of your salvation. It says the old ways are represented above the water. So when you walk into the water, you walk in your old ways, okay? And this is why it has to be an adult, right? There's no child baptism in the Bible. They're adults, right? And so when you walk into the water, you walk in your old ways, and you made a decision you're going to start living for something new when you decided to follow Jesus in the first step of obedience, right? To live for something new, listen, the old ways must die, right? You can't live for something new if you're stuck in the old, right? And buried with him in the likeness of his death. And that's what I say when I'm baptizing you. I ask you if you be saved, and I say in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with him in the likeness of his death. Your old ways go down. Boom. Right? Romans 6:4, we were buried, therefore, with him in baptism into death, that you died. We belong to something new. See, we represent Jesus. Now we become ambassadors to Christ, right? In Romans 6, 4, we were buried, therefore, with him in baptism unto death in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we belong to something new, raised for a new life, a new purpose, right? God's plan and purpose for our lives now, not my plan and purpose. Joe's plan and purpose died when I went under that water. When I came up, I have a new plan and purpose. All right? Romans 6:4, we were buried therefore with him in baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in what? Newness of life. Are you walking in newness of life? You know, some Christians aren't walking in newness of life. They don't understand the concept of what God has called them to. All right? We are alive in Christ. All right? The old is gone, the new is here. You know, if you've been saved for any period of time, there should be such a major difference in how you were then compared to how you are now. It's a constant growth state. Galatians 2:20, for I've been crucified with Christ. And what? I no longer live, but Christ now lives in me, or he lives through us. And so we have a new purpose and plan. God has a purpose and plan to do exactly what I just said. And next week's message is going to give you the process of what he uses to do that. All right, the old life is gone, the new life is here. Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ and no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Are you living the new life? The new life has a new leader, and it's not you. All right, there's a lot of self-denial in Christianity, right? This is what I want to do, but you know what? I know God doesn't want me to do that. This is what God wants me to do. And I may not feel like doing that all the time, but I'm going to do what God wants me to do now because I'm living the new life. Choices have to be made. John 12:26, whoever serves me wants what? Yeah, you can't serve him. Don't fool yourself. You're not following him. You're not picking up this word and going, you know, God, I want to stop doing what you want me to do. Don't fool yourself. My servant will also be. Not where you want God to be, where God wants you to be. Right? My Father will honor, listen, here's a little attachment to that. My Father will honor the one who serves me. So Christianity is all about service. You love and you're giving back for what God's already done for you, right? And what you're allowing Christ to do it, of course, through us, right? The new leader has a command for us, and this is where it all begins, right? Christianity is always about moving forward in life, right? Mark 16:15, he, Jesus, said to them, what did he say?
Go.
That's it. It's a forward march. You know what? God does not want you going back. Oh, I messed up here. No, God, forgive me. Go on, and you're full marching forward again. So you put the past behind you. Those things died when you went underwater. All right? And then when you came up, the immediate command is go. See, but here's the catch to this. We go even though we stay. Right? And Mark 16:15 said, he says to them, go into the world. Well, we were already in the world. Right? Did you arrive on Mars after you were baptized? No, you're still in the world, weren't you? He said, go into the world, but we're already in the world. All right? And go simply means to move out or away from a place or expression or implied, right? So we are still in the world, but with a new purpose in it, right? To go, we must be moving away from one place of thought to another. Mark 16:15, he said to them, go into the world, and now what's the next thing he tells you to do?
Preach
the gospel. You realize you're a preacher? And we're all preachers? You think, oh, Joe's a preacher. No, you are a preacher too. That commandment's to us all. Go into the world and preach the gospel. All right? Now, listen. Now, when you get this type of thinking on it, everything now has a new purpose. Your next-door neighbor has a new purpose now. I can preach the gospel. The people you work with, oh, God put them in my life to preach the gospel. All the people God surrounds you with. And you get this type of thinking, you'd be surprised how many people God brings into your life. Go and preach the gospel. That's the command. And now he's going to kind of direct it who he wants us to preach it to. Okay, so what does it say? Go and preach the gospel to all creation. All right? We are commanded to preach the gospel to everyone. anybody comes across our path. Somehow, some way. 1 Corinthians 9:16. Look at this verse. Yet preaching the gospel is not something I can what? Why would he say that? Because God expects you to do it. That was your first commit. It's not something you go, hey, I mean, I really preached the gospel once this month. God's not going to go, oh, good job. No, he expects it of you. That's the first, that's a command, right? And what does Paul say? The necessity is laid upon me. I need to do this because God commanded me to do it, all right? Necessity, the fact of being required or indispensable. It's a requirement of the Christian life, is to go forward and preach the gospel. I don't think Christians realize how important and significant this is. What good is it if you're out there in the world and you're not telling anything about Christ? What accomplishments are you really doing for God? What, they think you're a nice person? Oh, they're such a nice person. What does that do for God? Preach the gospel. So I'm going to give you some of that. Preach the gospel. Romans 10:9. Now, if you'll confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and you'll believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. Preach the gospel. The Bible has many verses on how you can preach the gospel. Preach the gospel. The gospel is by grace, unmerited favor. It has nothing to do with our works, right? Ephesians 2:8-9. For by grace you are saved through faith. It has nothing to do with you. Nothing to do with you. Right? It's a what? Gift. You do nothing for it. God simply says, here, you want it? And then you make a choice to take it. And that's what you tell people. You don't have to do anything for it. It doesn't cost you anything. The gospel is free. Not by what? What does that say? Works. You don't work your way into heaven. You could be the nicest guy in the world and not go to heaven. Not by works. So very important people understand the gospel is by grace, not works. All right, preach the gospel. God's righteousness has nothing to do with our righteousness. Philippians 3:9, and be found in him having, what? Not having my own righteousness. Nothing to do with Job. I'm not going to heaven because of something I did. I'm going to heaven because of something Jesus did. Not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, right? But which is through the faith of who? Christ. Christ has paid the price for sin on the cross, didn't he? Right? The righteousness which is of God by what? Faith. Any works there? Any deeds? No, that's the gospel. The gospel is grace. Preach the gospel. God's righteousness. Christ suffered for our sins once for all time. Right? You only have to get saved once. Once for all time. Right? He never sinned, but he died for sinners to bring you what? Savior. You can't get there unless you're doing it through him. Unless you have the sacrifice, unless you understand it's the grace, not works. That only through him. That's the gospel. He suffered physical death, but he was raised to life in the spirit. All right? Preach the gospel. There's another way to preach the gospel. I like how Paul did it, and that's your testimony. You don't always have to have words here sometimes. Sometimes you just tell, hey, this is what happened to me. This is how I got saved. This is how I became a Christian. And Paul talking, as I was on the road approaching Damascus about noon, a very bright light from heaven suddenly shone down around me, and there was Jesus, and then I heard a voice, and he told me all these things. And if you ever follow Paul, he keeps saying the same testimony over and over and over. So your personal testimony, preach the gospel. Hey, you know what? I used to be this way. I ran across somebody who told me about Jesus, and you know what? I'm a Christian today. Over and over and over. Preach the gospel. All right? We are commanded to preach the gospel. You need to understand it as a Christian. Mark 16:15, he said to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to, and I'm going to tell you what that means, to everyone. Everyone I put across your path in your life, you make sure you try to find a way to preach the gospel. And sometimes you just pass out tracts. I do that at work. Right? Preach the gospel. Have you been preaching the gospel? You talk to anyone this week about Jesus? Right? These are questions we need to ask ourselves, right? Because if we're not, we're not preaching the gospel. Okay? Do you know how to preach the gospel? You're commanded to do it. You might want to find that out. And then the other question is, do you know the gospel? You can't preach the gospel if you don't know the gospel. All right? The gospel. Go. Preach the gospel.
It's the full.
Are you living the new life? Are you preaching the gospel, right? Preaching the gospel is a necessary component for the new life. All right, 1 Corinthians 9:16, yet preaching the gospel is not something I can boast about, for necessity is laid upon me. How terrible for me if I didn't preach the gospel. How terrible for me if I go through my life and I'm not preaching the gospel. All right, willingly or unwillingly, we are commanded to preach the gospel. This isn't about how we feel. It's a command from God, all right? And this is where Christianity falls into the I want to do what God wants me to do, or I have to do what God wants me to do, right? And so either way, whatever motivates you, pick it because God wants you to do it, all right? You may be the person who goes, you know, I want to do what God wants me to do. You may go, oh, man, I got to do this, but I'm going to do it. I don't always feel like going to work either. Right? You ever always feel like going to work? You always feel like going to visit certain people? You're talking to certain people? No, you do it because you know it's the right thing to do. That's what God is, right? And then there's the other side, hey, God, you know, I love you. I may not feel like doing this right now, but I love you, and I want to do what you want me to do. And that's when you're being motivated out of love. And that's a stronger commitment to God. 1 Corinthians 9:17, for if I do this willingly, I have a reward. For if I do this willingly, I have what? Reward. Right? But against my will, a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me. But if it's not voluntarily, I'm still entrusted with the responsibility. We go preach the gospel to move out or away from a place expressed or implied. We can't go and preach the gospel. Listen, you cannot go and preach the gospel if you're looking back. You can't. If you're looking back at your old life, looking back at the world, the things you used to live for. Some Christians are still living for the same things they lived for when they got saved. All right? We can't go preach the gospel if we're looking back. Looking back at the things we're supposed to be moving away from, right? Luke 9:62. But Jesus told them, anyone who puts his hand to the plow and then looks back is what? Not fit for the kingdom of God. No, you go. You put that stuff behind you. We can't go, listen, if we do not have an allegiance to the one who commands us. James 4:4, you adulterers, don't you realize that friendship with the world makes you a what? An enemy of God. All right? If I say it again, if you want to be a friend of the world, you make yourself an enemy of God. All right? We can't go unless we're loyal to the one who commands us. James 1:8, a double-minded person, listen to this, their loyalty is divided between God and what? Yeah, they're stuck looking back, aren't they? Right? And they are unstable in everything they do. And what God is simply saying there, I can't use you for anything. Right? You're either all in with God, or you're not in at all. Make a decision and go. All right? She could not go and look back. Genesis 19:26, but Lot's wife looked back, and what she happened to her? They told her, listen, go and don't look back, right? Same thing God's telling us to do. Go and don't look back. And the angel said, go and don't look back. We can't go and look back either. Matthew 5:13, you are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its saltiness, that means you're not salt being a salt of the earth. You're not giving the gospel. How can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under the foot of men. All right? We belong to something new. Living for something new requires a new point of view. And before we can understand the concept of something new, we first need to understand the meaning of belonging. And that's one of the problems with Christians as we go through our life. We don't understand what belonging means. When God says you belong to something new, the concept of understanding belonging will help us in our thought process of the goal, all right? We belong to be the property of a person or thing, to be attached or bound by birth, allegiance, or dependency, all right? To be the property of a person or thing, we would first have to be purchased. And what does it say in 1 Corinthians 6:20? You were bought by God with what? High price, the life of his son. That's what it costs God to purchase you, his son. You were bought with a high price. All right? Jesus gave his life for yours. He paid for your sin with his life. All right? Right? Understanding that we are God's property means that we no longer belong to ourselves. So you need to remind yourselves, I don't belong to myself anymore. I belong to God. I am his property now. Right? We are in agreement with God despite contrary opinion or feelings. Listen, don't let your feelings get you through your Christian life. You'll feel one way one day another, one way I'll feel this way, one day I'll feel another. No, you make a choice and a decision. I'm the property of God. He commanded me to go, and I'm going to do what he wants me to do in this life. All right, 1 Corinthians 6:19. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit? Listen, I'm going to try to put this. Don't you even know that God's Spirit is living in you? Do you know that? Do you know God's Spirit lives in you? Do you know that? That's what he's saying. Do you know that? Don't you know that? You should know that. It says you were sealed with the Spirit. Don't you know that? That's what he's saying right there, right? Who is where? Where is he? Right? Who is in you? Whom you what? Received from who?
God.
Right? From God, right? And what does it say next? You are not your own. You no longer belong to yourself. You're God's property, all right? And some Christians don't know that. Remind yourself. Belonging to somebody comes with expectations from the one who made the purchase, right? If I bought a car, I would have certain expectations, right? I want it to drive, right? Those are the expectations. And if I bought a more expensive car, I have a higher expectation of the vehicle, right? If you spend $1,000 on a vehicle, you're not going to have very high expectations, are you? If you spend $100,000 on a vehicle, you have big expectations, don't you? It costs God his son. God has big expectations. He paid a high price for you. He paid everything he had. Right? God is expecting expectations of his property. He expects a return on his investment in you. You owe God. He gave you life. You owe him. Right? He expects us to live up to our potential. Right? 1 Corinthians 6:20. You were bought by God with a high price, so you what? Must honor God with your body. Must. It's a must. It's a high expectation. This is an expectation from the one who owns you. All right? We are not living the new life. Listen, if we're not living the new life, we're wasting our life. All right? That rocky clip, Galatians 4:9. But now that you know God, or rather are known by God, listen, he's going to ask a question. How is it that you're turning back to those weak and miserable things? Why are you going back to your old life? Why are you living for the same thing everybody else lives for? Do you wish to be enslaved to them all over again? I came to set you free from that stuff. All right? And then so we have to ask ourselves some questions, right? Ask ourselves some questions. What foundation am I building my life on? Right? We have choices to make based upon the information God gives us. Listen, we're all given the same Bible. We all pick it up, and if you say you put your faith in Christ, well, it's your requirement to pick this up, read it, and find out what God wants you to do. I'm just giving you one area, right? And God says, when you build your life on the things I say, and you're obedient to what I tell you, and he gives you some foundations you could build your life on. Anyone who builds on foundations may use a variety of materials. You could build your life on gold, silver, or jewels. Or you could build your life on wood, hay, and straw. Of course, it doesn't take a whole lot to figure out which one might be the better foundation to be building on here. I don't know many houses built on wood, hay, or straw that would stand too strong, right? All right? How we think will determine our success. New life, I'm building my life on gold, silver, and jewels. I'm building my life on what God says. The old life, wood, hay, and straw. You know, I'm going to live my life like everyone else and live the same things they live for. I want money. I want my money, my family, my things here, And God's like way down here on the list. Right? 1 Corinthians 3:13. Listen to this. But on judgment day, the fire will reveal what kind of work each builder has done. Right? And that fire will show if a person's work had any value. Or you'll still go to heaven. But will the life you have lived on this earth have had any value when you get to the one you were made for? That's what God's saying. Do you want to live for something that is authentic? Something that is real? Something that will have value at the end of your life? Ephesians 5:15. Oh, be careful how you what? Be careful how you live. All right? Don't live like fools, but like those who are wise. Right? But prosperity gospel, some churches actually preach that God's going to bless you with this and do this for you and do this for you. Life's going to be easy. Don't live like fools. Get out there and preach the gospel. I don't care if I'm poor, I'm rich, I'm where I'm at. God's going to take care of me, and I'm going to go forward, and I'm going to do what he wants me to do in this life. All right? God has called us to a new life. He's called us to a new purpose. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are what? A new creation. You're a new creation. God created you as a new creation. When you went down into that water, you died. And you came up for a new life, a new creation. All right? The old ways must die. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, anyone in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has passed away. Has the old passed away? Yeah. All right, the new life has begun. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, new has come. All right, I see the dawn of a new beginning. This time, we can't go home. We look forward to our new home and say goodbye to our old. Luke 9:61-62, yet another said, I will follow you, Lord. I'll follow you, Lord. A lot of people say, we say that. I'll follow you, Lord. I'll follow you, Jesus. But there's always there's some buts in there, a lot of buts, right? But, you know, let me first go say farewell to those who are at home. Jesus said to them, no one who puts their hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. New life. We let go of the past. Philippians 3:13. Now, dear brothers and sisters, I have not achieved it, but I focus on one thing, forgetting the past and looking what? Forward to what God has ahead. What do you got for me today, God? I messed up a few times yesterday, but what do you got for me today? All right, a lot of messing up for me yesterday, is believe me. But you know what? Put it behind you. God forgive me, and you move forward. All right? I hear the streets of tomorrow calling. I go where you go. A new beginning has a new calling. Jesus called to them and said, come follow me, and I'll show you how to what?
Fish.
For who? What are you fishing for? Yeah, that's right. That's the calling. That's the gospel. Right? Get the gospel out there. Mark 16:15, he says to them, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation, making disciples.
Jesus has been speaking through this sermon about freedom from loneliness.
Because we belong to something new. Right? Something new. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And so next week, I want to go into how God does that within us with that Holy Spirit of his. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for your word, Lord. And I pray, God, all of us, Lord, would start going and living the new life. And just trust your plan and reaching out and preaching the gospel. In Jesus' name, amen. That's it, guys.